Yeah, hi everyone, good afternoon. So despite what Melanie said yesterday, I don't think everybody knows who I am. So I am a PI at Columbia, and I also run a research institute called Basis. We started last year, and we kind of tried to scale up some of the things that I'll be talking about today. And so today I'll be talking about meaning through modeling, and so we'll see what that means. And so this is joint work with many people from Basis, MIT, and Cornell, and other places. And as some background, one of the key ideas that I find fascinating is the idea of mental models, which we just heard about. And we heard about yesterday from Josh and others. And despite what John says, there's lots of evidence that people use these mental models to simulate how the world will unfold, to make predictions, to make decisions. My personal interests are, you know, less around kind of the cognitive science, although, you know, I did study cognitive science, but more about normative models. Like, you know, what are the right ways to build models of the world? What are the right ways to reason? And can we build systems that emulate or kind of incorporate some of these principles? And so today I'll be talking about a few things, and I'll be going through some questions, some ideas, and some speculations as we go through. I'll get kind of more and more speculative towards the end. And to start, I'll just start with this question that came up yesterday around language models. So there was the claim that kind of next token prediction is AI complete. And so for the uninitiated, AI complete means this is as hard as any AI problem. If you can solve this, you can solve any other AI problem. And so, you know, is it true? Are there problems which are kind of fall outside of this Marcus loop? And I genuinely don't know, but one thing I've been thinking about is this example. And so here's a kind of a story that actually GPT helped me make. So, you know, it is amazing. And so it's an agony aunt story. And so I think in America, this is a Dear Abby or something like this. And so the basic idea is there's a guy called Bob, and he's, you know, he's met a woman called Linda. Bob's 32, and he's fallen in kind of in love with Linda, and he's asking, is Linda too old for him, right? And so I've asked GPT to answer as his agony aunt, yes or no, is the age gap too large? And GPT answers no. You know, great, nothing, you know, nothing too kind of crazy about that.
That's a good answer.
But we can follow up and ask, you know, how would you have answered, you know, had I chosen a different age? So rather than Linda being 48, suppose she was, you know, older. And GPT answers, well, you know, I can't answer this question. I'm a language model. I don't have opinions. This is a personal choice, right? Which is, you know, very progressive. But is it true? Is that actually how GPT would have answered? And, you know, the cool thing is that we can actually go in and just run the experiment. So we can repeat the experiment and change the value of Linda's age from 48 up, you know, up through to, you know, 90 or 100. And see what, you know, what the response is. And so the actual response is this. And so, you know, despite what ChatGPT said, it does have an opinion about what is too old. And in this case, around 70 is too old in ChatGPT's mind. So what does this mean? So I would say that there's a kind of a matter of factness about ChatGPT's wrongness about its ability to reason counterfactually about itself. Maybe my stronger claim is that I don't think this is going to improve in GPT-5 or GPT-6. It might, you know, again, I'm not certain, without kind of major changes to how these models are trained. And so why do I think that? Why do I think that in a few months we're going to get a new model and that's not just going to, you know, I'm going to be one of these people who has claimed something which is no longer true? A few things of different degrees of importance. So one is just architecture. You know, do these transformer models have enough kind of introspection into their own mechanics to be able to answer these kind of questions? I think currently probably not, but maybe in the future, I think that could change. I think a more important point is my second point, which I haven't got a good name for, but it would be something like transience. And the idea is that there's really no problem in the training set, which is like the problem that we just addressed. And that is because meta-reasoning is a function of like your current state of knowledge. right? You know, I've got this question, how would I have answered? I have to simulate myself. And as you're training the system, you know, it's never in the kind of the post-trained stage, right? So in other words, even if you took this, you know, these slides and you fed them into GPT so it could see this exact same example as it was training, it wouldn't be in the same, you know, when it got to its final training state, it would have changed. It would have become a new entity. And its reasoning, you know, would have changed as well, right? So its knowledge would have changed. And so you have this kind of almost like circular problem where I think it might be, you know, almost impossible to get this kind of meta reasoning capacity just from next token prediction. That could not be true. You know, GPT could just learn a very general meta reasoning capacity that just emerges. But I think it might be difficult, and I don't see any difference in GPT-4 versus GPT-3 for this particular instance. And I think even if we could solve this issue, I think probably the best we could hope for is emulating human biases. You know, humans, probably many of you thinking, we're not very good at, you know, fully introspecting into our mind about how we reason. But, you know, I don't think that should be the bar. I think we should, you know, try to get the right answer if one exists. So what does this have to do with, you know, meaning, other than just giving me an excuse to use a language model in my opening slides? So, you know, these kind of brackets came up, I think, yesterday in somebody's talk, and really they're a notation for saying, you know, what does this sentence mean, right? And I've rephrased it slightly, but the question is, you know, what does it mean? Like the age at which you in this case being ChatGPT would have answered differently. Let's bring another example. You know, I might say, well, you know, had this barrier not been here, that the car would have tumbled down the side of the cliff. You know, what does that statement mean? Is it true? Here's another example I saw a few years ago when Mike Pence was debating with Joe Biden, right? And Joe, you know, he says, you know, if swine flu had been as lethal as the coronavirus in 2009 when Joe Biden was vice president, we would have lost 2 million American lives, right? So this, you know, the statement has some meaning, and it's a question of whether it's true or not, right? It turns out that we did lose almost 2 million lives, but at the time that wasn't close to being true. And so, you know, my claim, and it's not my claim, my claim that I'm inheriting is that these statements, they do have a true meaning, right? And they're cashed out in the notion of counterfactuals. And the basic idea behind a counterfactual, which I'm kind of illustrating here, but this is not a real model, is that there are possible worlds on the x-axis, and we have these possible ways that the world might unfold. And in the middle graph, we can kind of add evidence. We can condition our model, which means that we now think that, you know, of all the ways that the world might evolve, only some of them are true. And the counterfactual on the right-hand side is this kind of weird operation where we do an intervention. We cut into the world and say, like, what if something had been different? And the weirdness comes from the fact that even though, you know, our evidence is not true in our counterfactual, it still influences our counterfactual, right? Because it influences what we believe about the latent states of the world. And so this idea of causal reasoning or counterfactual reasoning, again, it's not new. What we've been working on and what I've been working on is how do we kind of push that to a kind of greater degree of complexity? And so Josh spoke yesterday about, you know, probabilistic programming, and we've been working on causal probabilistic programming. And the basic idea, you know, at least 3 points. One is universality. We want to use kind of universal Turing machines to represent models of the world. It's very similar to kind of the universal function approximation theorem that kind of drives a lot of the insights in deep learning. And two, we want declarative reasoning. I want to be able to say, like, you know, what if or why, right? And these questions that have meaning somewhat independent of my algorithm to implement them. But three, I actually do want algorithms that actually do compute the answers to these questions. And so here's an example, and you know, you could call it a toy example, but this is the kind of example that we can simulate in a system that I've built called Omega. And within Basis, we're building a kind of a new version called Causal Pyro, which is kind of more highly engineered. Suppose you're kind of driving a car, and this, you know, this pedestrian kind of jumps out, and you crash into this pedestrian. And suppose it's just like a single image of the car at some point. So there's many questions that you could ask. But one question is, you know, to determine whether the driver's speed was the cause of the accident, right? And this is an important question in society. And so the way that Omega and these systems work is that you write down a model, you write down a program that simulates the world, and you simulate the driver's dynamics, you simulate the graphics that relates the objects to the image that you're seeing, you simulate the physics, and then you add data. And the data are, you know, what you actually observed. And then you can ask your questions. So what would have happened had the obstacle been in a different place? What would have happened had the driver been going more quickly or slowly? And these systems will automatically compute the answer for you. And so what this is showing is kind of the distance between the pedestrian and the car. In other words, like when it's zero, the pedestrian is, you know, the car's crashed into the pedestrian. Under these two different scenarios, like one, if the car was going faster, and two, if the obstacle was in a different place. And so the conclusion from this system is that, well, actually, you know, the driver was speeding, but even if he wasn't, he probably still would have crashed into the pedestrian. And so this is the kind of reasoning that, you know, we can do approximately as humans, and it's the kind of reasoning that we would want our machines to do, right? And it's also the kind of reasoning that I wouldn't want to delegate right now to something like ChatGPT, because who knows what kind of answer you would get out. Okay, so we've built, you know, many systems of this form. And one of the key takeaways is that these systems, these universal causal probabilistic programming languages, they capture a lot of what we think about in terms of common sense, right? You can express very complex things, you can express your reasoning queries, both for, you know, for that, but also for scientific reasoning. And there's this really interesting duality between the two different domains and overlap. But there are still many kind of challenges, both in terms of algorithmic complexity and also in the representations that we use. Okay, so one kind of critique that comes from this to this paradigm is, where do these models come from? You know, I've sat down and written this model. And one of the nice things about neural networks is that you can learn these models from data. And so we've been asking this question, you know, how can we, you know, how can a mind, you know, a kind of a real or an artificial mind, you know, learn structured models, you know, of the world, perhaps like similar to how a human does? And here's some work, you know, I'm sure many of you are familiar with, which is done by, you know, Allison and others, of a Blicket machine, right? And so, you know, this is a machine where if you put, you know, you put items on this machine, it can play a sound or not play a sound, depending on the items that have been put on the machine. And what Allison and others have shown is that children are pretty good and have idiosyncrasies in how they learn the causal dynamics of the objects and how the machine responds to these interventions. And they can do it pretty quickly, and they can do it, you know, with small amounts of data. And so we've been thinking about, you know, what is kind of the computational, maybe that's too strong, like what is a computational story about how this could work? And can we build models, you know, which not experimentally, but kind of capture some of the qualitative features of this kind of model learning? And so one key question is like, you know, what is the model, right? What is the model of the world? And going back to what I just mentioned, we can think about models as programs, right? Programs are, you know, one of the best tools that we've developed as a society to model things in the world, right? And so perhaps it's not too much of a stretch to suggest that perhaps we have something like programs, you know, in our minds. And so we've been taking this idea literally and trying to build systems that observe kind of worlds a little bit like the environment that I just showed you, and try to synthesize the underlying mechanics and rules of those worlds. And so I'll just show you a kind of an example of this. Okay, so you can, yeah, they can see it, right?
We can see this.
Okay. Do you want me to move it over, or just keep it here?
As long as you don't mind sharing with that, we
can see. That's fine. This is what I'm going to show. Okay, so this is a very simple environment. And there's the code on the left-hand side. This is the underlying theory or model. And on the right-hand side, there's a kind of an interactive domain. And I think it'll be fun just to kind of do this interactively. So I'll interact with this domain. And perhaps, like, raise your hand if you feel, like when you feel confident that you know how this world works, and by how it works, you have some understanding by whatever notion of understanding you've kind of convinced yourself of. Okay, so I'm gonna click, and I'll tell you when I'm clicking. Oops, sorry, one sec.
Could someone move that chair?
Oh, can you not see?
I can't.
Then I think you can drag that.
Should I just drag it over?
Yeah, it's pretty small.
Okay.
You will need to switch what you're sharing to the Zoom now. I just didn't know if that'd be tricky, because they're not, Zoom's not going to see it anymore.
Okay. I will try and do that.
Yeah. I would have had you switch early. I just didn't want to break the Zoom sharing, which seems just
like the trolley problem.
Yeah, yeah. I don't actually know how to switch. There.
Stop sharing. Yeah, but that's Dan Dennett. All right, there we go.
Me who can't read. Okay, so like I said, raise your hand when you feel like you have a good understanding. That's not a trick question. This is a particularly simple domain. Okay, actually, it's pretty too, it's too fast. Let me just slow that down. Okay, so I've clicked. Well, I know Josh knows because he's clicking again. Half a hand. Clicking again. Yes. Maybe it's more complex than I thought. Okay, so this is a pretty simple domain. It's just, well, actually, do you want to describe as a half hand raiser?
Yeah, it's only half hand, so. I think it seems to be what's happening is that they're just moving with some relatively randomly to adjacent squares in each time step. It does seem like they survive if they overlap. They don't become a single cell. They seem to have individual identities. It doesn't seem that it's wrapping toroidally, right? So it seems like they're coming. They can come back from off the screen. Other than that, I'm not sure. Is that right?
Yeah, it's pretty much it. Yeah. And one thing which was probably almost too obvious for you to mention was, which is that when I click, a particle, you know, comes down, right? Yeah. but you do have to learn that, right? Okay, so a more complex one. In some ways, but in others. Okay, so here's a little world.
So that's
a click. Also, if anyone wants to tell me what to do, I can also take direction.
Click in one of the colors and then somewhere else.
Hypothesis testing.
It's running up now. The time steps are ticking.
Yep, yeah, it's running. Click
the blue one.
Try blue.
You click on one of the pre-existing things here at the bottom.
Wait, click blue first and I'll do your...
Can you create blue on top of another color?
Oh.
Oh.
Right. Oh. Oh.
Water, it smells about.
Okay, I'm going to fast forward, otherwise.
What happens if you put a blue somewhere in the fourth row from the left?
Fourth row from the left?
And you're the top of blue.
Me?
Yeah.
It's going in. Oh, no. Shocking.
Your function, you're too insistent in reading all your functions. And it gives away the entire function of code.
Water.
Right. Okay, so I'm going to show you red. So red deletes everything. Okay, so this is... a little simulation of a water plug. The idea is that this is water, it's a plug. I can take the plug out. But most people, they have this kind of aha moment when they see the blue one. Okay, but you know what?
It's been a long day.
Yeah. You know what we're trying to model is this process of observing what you've observed and trying to synthesize something like the understanding that you have, and some model of that is something like the program that we have on the left-hand side. You know, I'm not saying that you have this exact syntax, right, but you have some means to represent these rules, these dynamics, these interventions, and so on. And I think I'm going to go vastly over time, so let me just speed through. Okay.
Okay.
So I need to go back.
What's interesting to me, though, that just having those function calls on the left, just that single word of water and plug, have to run it.
Right.
And so the words encode so much information about the dynamics.
Right.
Right. Yeah, that was my point, is that you, instead of having to run that program, word plug does so much work. Mm-hmm. It just short circuits that, mm-hmm. right?
Okay, so what we've been building is, you know, precisely what I just said, algorithms that observe, you know, some comparable amount of data, seconds to minutes, and synthesize the source code that you saw on the left-hand side or something equivalent. And one of the key problems with this, key challenges here is the idea of latent state. In other words, you can't actually fully infer the underlying world dynamics purely from the observational data. And so this example is a kind of a Mario simulation where you have a character running around. But also in this version of Mario, he can collect coins, and these coins allow him to shoot a single bullet. So one coin, one bullet, and he has to try and kill this kind of blue thing at the top, which is bouncing around. And so you can be in two situations which are kind of observationally equivalent, right? Same frame. In situation A, you've got no bullets in your backpack, but there's no way to tell that, and you try and shoot, nothing happens. In situation B, you shoot, you do have bullets, and something happens, right? And so somehow, a system has to be able to say, well, actually, there's some underlying structure here which is going to explain the difference between these two scenarios. And so we built a system which essentially does this. It's called AutumnSynth because this language or environment is called Autumn. This is a work between myself, Josh, Armando, and Ria Das, a master student who did a lot of the work here. And the basic idea is that AutumnSynth produces programs with, you know, relatively small amounts of data. And I'll just run through very quickly about how it works. We have this language called Autumn. It's a simple functional language that allows you to express these dynamical systems. You can talk about interventions and time and previous values in the history. You can talk about objects and object dynamics. And the algorithm is composed of a bunch of parts, and many of which are heuristic, certainly not end-to-end trained, including perception, tracking phase, and a phase where we find these kind of primitive dynamics between different time steps, and then when we abstract that to find some more general rules. And one of the key things here is that it's iterative. So we make a kind of a hypothesis, we see how that's kind of wrong, and then we revise our hypothesis to make it better, a little bit like science. So just zooming through, this is kind of the perception stage, and then we find these kind of local dynamics in a kind of a big table, and then we abstract that, and we can infer through a bunch of steps, which I don't have time to get into, the underlying latent state, the underlying dynamics. And like I said, we have this kind of recursive process where we go back and refine the relationship if our hypothesis doesn't fully explain the data. And the takeaway here is that for the example that I just showed you, and many of the examples, 30 or so, we can actually synthesize these models relatively quickly from like pretty small amounts of data. This is not big data deep learning. Okay, and so continuing, AutumnSynth is a new method, and I think it captures some of human-like error-driven discovery. In many ways, it's very different. It's many heuristics, but the essence of revising your theories in response to data and using relatively small amounts of data, I think, are kind of a key insights that this method has captured. But like before, there's still many algorithmic and representational challenges to scale this up. Okay, so related to that, one of the things that I've been thinking about, and another critique of this class of, let's say, symbolic methods, is they just don't scale as well as these neural methods. And related to, I think Tom's talk yesterday, how can we represent symbolic structure within a neural system, and is that a kind of a wise thing to do? And there's a bunch of ways that people have been thinking about this. You can encode kind of language models and probabilistic, deep neural networks within a symbolic Bayesian model. You can use kind of neural networks to kind of speed up inference. And so there's a whole kind of family of different methods that try and incorporate these things. But I've been thinking about a way which I think is a little bit different to those. And this is an idea I've had a very long time ago. And it's always been on the back burner, but I think it's relevant to this particular audience. And so one of the key ideas you see in computer science is this idea of a data structure, right? There are things that, such as stacks and queues and even models, right? And geometric objects. And what does it mean to be, for example, a stack or a queue or a number? Well, there's many different answers to that, but one answer is that it obeys some kind of interface, right? It does what it's supposed to do. So for example, for a stack, right, which is a computer science data structure, it's some kind of thing where you can put things onto the stack and you can pop pop things from that stack, right? And the thing that you pop off should be the thing that you just put on, right? If you do these two things in sequence. And that, in some sense, defines the laws of a stack, right? And it doesn't really matter how you implement that stack, right? As long as it does that thing, then in some sense, it's a stack. And you can say the same thing for a number or for a set or all of these really rich structures that are kind of foundational to mathematics and you should, you know, everyday kind of common sense living and reasoning. And so this, you know, this is very, you know, strong idea from Marr, which is that you can think about, you know, systems at different levels of analysis. And you know, the level that I just described is this kind of highest level, right? This kind of this computational level. And perhaps we can specify our systems at that high level, and these kind of lower levels we can be a little bit more agnostic about. And so what, you know, again, an old project that I worked on is maybe we can implement, you know, these high-level structures with these lower-level kind of neural interfaces. And so basically, you know, long story short, I built a system that emulates or simulates many of these kind of symbolic, traditionally symbolic structures by observational equivalence. In other words, it learns to imitate what a normal stack does at particular points. So you write a program that uses a stack, right, that does some operations, and it learns a neural stack. And what does it mean to learn a neural stack? Well, you learn a function for push, you learn a function for pop, you learn a constant for the empty stack. And in some sense, once you've done that, you have a kind of a bona fide stack. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, here, you know, here is kind of in operation. So in the middle layer, on the left-hand side, you see what it's learned as this kind of constant vector for an empty stack, and it's this kind of weird, this weird little object. And what I'm showing you here is the result of pushing three items onto this stack and popping three items. And so the first thing to note is that it works, right? I can push on 8, 6, 4, and I can pop, and I get back 4, 6, 8, right? And so the stack works in the way that I would expect a stack to work. But if you look closely at this internal representation, it's learned to interlace the numbers that I've put on to this stack in an interesting way, right? Which is kind of hard to, you know, just define a priori, right? But it's learned some internal representation of how to represent three numbers, or three images of numbers stacked together in a way which would allow it in the future to pop, take those numbers off the stack into the future. And so, you know, there's a lot of history of using, of implementing neural stacks and this kind of thing, but there's no kind of architectural choice here which makes this a stack, right? You can use a convolutional network, you can use the MLP. It's just that this is a stack in the sense that it adheres to the high level notion of what it means to be a stack. And you can kind of, you know, do this for other data structures, right? You can do it for a queue, for, you know, for number, right? For all these, you know, algebraic structures, as long as you know in some high-level sense of what it means to be that thing. And so the takeaway here is that I think, you know, one way to think about combining neural and symbolic methods is not to kind of fine-tune architectures, but to say what we want at the highest kind of computational level of these data structures. Okay, so final thing, I'll just take, you know, 2 minutes. Another big kind of missing piece in my view of this kind of paradigm of Bayesian and probabilistic modeling is the idea of like a single model. And what instead could it mean to have multiple models of the same thing? And one example, again, that I've been thinking about for a while is this question of how tall is Melania Obama? So I was thinking about this when she was actually the daughter of the current president. And here's the kind of, you know, typical response. I asked a bunch of people this question, and they would say things like this. Well, I don't know for sure, but she's the daughter of Barack Obama. I think he's tall. If not, you know, presidents tend to be tall, so he's probably tall. Come to think of it, I think her mother's also tall. Actually, I think I've seen them side by side, and I think they were kind of similar heights. So she must be quite tall. So perhaps she's 5'11". She's actually taller than that. She's like 6'1". But the important thing for me here is that to answer this question, the person has deployed many different models about how the world works, right? Models of genetic inheritance, models of like geometric, you know, height and images of people, right? Models of presidents and power, right? And so if we're going to think, you know, if we're making the claim that we can build kind of models of the world, right? Either we have like one model of everything, like, you know, simulation of the entire universe, which seems implausible, or we have multiple models which somehow kind of cohere and connect. And so it's a hard question, like, what does it mean to have multiple models? A simpler one is like, what does it even mean to have a single model of a thing? And, you know, I don't know, right? And this is, the most speculative part. But I think if we look at something as simple as a map, like what does it mean for a map to be a map, right? In some sense, some invariances hold between the map and reality. I can use this map to make inferences about the world. And similar things for abstraction. So this is in computer science. If I want to check if two objects intersect, I can make a model of those objects, a more coarse model, right? A kind of a bounding box, and I can check whether those bounding boxes intersect. And if they do, then I know. If they don't, then I know my my more fine-grained objects won't intersect. And if they do, then I have to do a more fine-grained check. And so where this is leading me is that I think there's a notion of kind of rational abstraction or rational modeling, where basically the purpose of an abstraction or of a model is to reduce the computational resources required to kind of solve some query. And as a corollary, the usefulness of an abstraction or a model is a degree to which it facilitates the use of fewer resources to answer the kinds of questions we want to answer. And now we're just in picture land, right? But the way I see this going is rather than thinking about single models, building like vast hierarchies, or maybe even hierarchies is the wrong word, but vast structures of models which are interconnected through basically abstraction relationships. And my biggest speculation is that if you can define this, I think that we'll get something closer to what we mean by meaning, right? We'll get something closer to what's required to answer the Malia-Obama question. And I think we'll get something closer to what we mean by concepts as the intersection of a variety of different models pertaining to a variety of different things. And so with that, I will just say my concluding remarks. I think much of what we, much of meaning can be kind of thought of or cashed out in terms of transformations of models. I think the specific representations of models and other structures is kind of less important than the functional role they play. And third, I think a major gap that we have to fill is to think about polystructural models, for lack of a better term, which combine various different levels of abstraction and approximation. And with that, I will